بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه ما بعد. Today and tomorrow, inshallah, we will be doing a brief primer on the fiqh of zakah. And that is because it is essential, as you know, to give our zakah once a year. And most of us choose to do it in Ramadan. And I get always questions asked about zakah. So there has been a demand to talk about the fiqh of zakah so that we give our zakah properly. Realize, my dear brothers and sisters, as we are all aware, that zakah is one of the fundamental pillars of our religion. It is mentioned in the Quran combined with salah more than 30 times. الَّذِينَ يُقِيمُونَ الصَّلَاةَ وَيُؤْتُونَ الزَّكَاةَ. They are paired together. Praying and giving charity are paired together more than 30 times. And in fact, as you all are aware, that after the death of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, groups of tribes, they decided, we don't want to give zakah. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq declared that those groups who refuse to give zakah cannot be considered Muslims. So he considered zakah to be a fundamental pillar, such that somebody who said, I don't have to give zakah, and he denies that he has to give zakah, this person, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and the Sahaba, they considered to be outside the fold of Islam. And therefore zakah is of the fundamental pillars, as in the famous hadith of Jibreel, when he was asked about the five pillars. So we know that one of those pillars was in fact the zakah. And zakah is not an income tax, but rather a savings tax. And the word zakah means to purify. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا. The one who purified the soul has been successful. And from the word purification, we understand the goal of zakah. Zakah is not meant to be a burden on us. Zakat is meant to purify our wealth for us. It's as if our wealth is not good. It's unhealthy. It is going to harm us. When we give zakah, then our wealth becomes pure for us to consume. And also one of the meanings of zakah is to become blessed. And so to grow. So when we give zakah, the money has barakah. The money actually grows more. And that's why we are told that when we give zakah, our money does not go down. It actually increases. And Allah Azza wa Jal commands the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, خُذْ مِنْ أَمْوَالِهِمْ صَدَقَةً تُطَهِّرُهُمْ بِهَا وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ. Take from their money their sadaqah. Take from their wealth their charity. That charity, Allah says, تُطَهِّرُهُمْ بِهَا. That charity will purify them. وَتُزَكِّيهِمْ. And it will cleanse them of their sins. So in the Quran, our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is commanded, you have to collect their zakah, and when you collect their zakah, they will become pure, and that money will become good for them, and it will purify them. As well, of course, zakah makes us think of those who are less fortunate than us. Because when we give zakah, we have to find out who is going to take that zakah. So we have to go looking around, who are the people that deserve that zakah? And in that search, our hearts should soften. When we find people who are deserving of zakah, we are aware of the blessings on us. We are aware that our religion tells us to take care of those that are neglected, of the widows, of the orphans. So we become sympathetic, and we then freely give unto others. And of course, zakah not only purifies our wealth, it also purifies us from stinginess, from miserliness, from greed, from conceit. So when we give to others, we become better people. And that is why zakah is an obligation upon us. Who gives zakah? Every single Muslim who owns more than, the technical term is the nisab, and one Islamic year has gone by. So every Muslim who owns more than the bare minimum that the Sharia has specified, and 1 year has gone by, they have to give zakah. And realize that there are three types of charities in the Quran. There is zakah, and the hadith mentions zakatul fitr number 2, and then there is sadaqah. And the difference is actually very straightforward. Zakat is the annual charity that we're talking about in this khatib today. Zakatul Fitr is the charity that is due for Ramadan only. It is obligatory and only for Ramadan, and I'll talk about that towards the end of this month. And it is a nominal amount, $7 or $10 per person, depending on how you extract the calculation from the amount of wheat. It's a small amount once a year, Zakatul Fitr. That's in Ramadan for our fasting. And then the third category is general sadaqah, just to give charity above and beyond zakah. That's not obligatory, but the more that you give, the more Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give back to us. Our lecture today is about the first category, which is the obligatory zakah. What are we required to give? So what wealth is zakatable? This is an English Arabic word that is now common. It's actually going to enter the dictionary soon, inshallah, because people are using it all the time. Zakatable. What wealth is zakatable? Which wealth do you calculate your zakat from? There are five categories, and we will only go into detail for the first two of them. The other three we'll just mention and then move on. The first category, which is the main category, is gold and silver, and by extension, currencies. So the number one category, you give zakat on gold and silver, and by extension, the modern currencies. And so bank accounts, stocks, money held in retirement funds, this is category one, which is basically our cash and all that is derived from that. Number two, business commodities. This will only apply if you run and operate a business. If you are a salaried employee who does not have any business, then this will not apply to you. But if you own a company, or if you own a buying and selling a trades, if you own a gas station, if you own a furniture store, then this is the second category, that is business zakat. And this is basically commodities of business, items that a merchant will buy and sell. And we'll go into a little bit of detail about that as well tomorrow as well. The third category, which we will not discuss, but you should be aware of, is livestock. If you own certain quantities of animals, and all of these quantities are more than a small amount. So if you own a chicken in your backyard, that's not zakat. But if you own, you know, many camels, many goats, and each category of animals has a different number, so there is zakat due on livestock. And the fourth category is zakat on agricultural produce if you are a farmer. We're not talking about your tomatoes in your backyard. We're talking about if you own acres and acres of farmland and you are a farmer, then there's zakat on the produce. And the fifth and final category, this is zakat on, the Arabic word is rikaz. And rikaz is translated as treasure trove. So if you own some land and you come across some treasure that is buried there, or in our times, many fuqaha say, if you discover an oil field in the backyard, firstly, call me up and we'll be good friends, inshallah, after that. But secondly, there's an issue of zakat on natural resources in your land. This is ar-rikaz. So category 3, 4, and 5, frankly, I wouldn't even know off the top of my head. I memorized the charts of livestock back when I was a second year undergraduate in Medina. Since then, I've never once even looked at that chart. How much zakat on how many camels and how many cows and sheep I have totally forgotten. But in case you own 77 sheep, come to me and I'll look it up for you. But otherwise, there's no need to go into the livestock or the agriculture. We are interested in the first two categories, and that is gold and silver and currencies, and then obviously business commodities. The technical stuff I'll delay for tomorrow because there is some technical stuff. What is the zakat on your own personal items? By unanimous consensus of all the scholars of Islam, there is no zakat on the items that you use to live your life. For example, the house that you live in. For example, the cars that you drive. For example, the clothes that you wear. The food in your house. There is no zakat. You simply do not look at that for calculation. The only issue of controversy is that of gold and silver jewelry that is owned by the women. I hope the men don't own any gold jewelry. They should not be owning any gold jewelry. But gold and silver, that is the only exception. And by the way, I mean gold and silver. If a lady has platinum or diamonds or whatnot, there is no zakat on that for her jewelry. There is no zakat on that. It's only on gold and silver jewelry. This is where our classical scholars have differed. Does gold and silver jewelry constitute currency, in which case there will be zakat, or does it constitute household items, in which case there is no zakat? And we'll get to this controversy in a while, inshallah ta'ala. So what is the bare minimum? What is the nisab amount? The sharia came with quantities of gold and silver, and the hadith mentions basically the equivalent of 3 ounces of gold or 21 ounces of silver. Now in those days, 3 ounces of gold and 21 ounces of silver was the equivalent. That was the exchange rate. Well, 1,440 years have gone by since then. These days, 3 ounces of gold is around $4,000. 21 ounces of silver is around $400. So the thing has changed immensely, the exchange rate. So the bottom line is that pretty much every person living in this land will have more than $300-$400, especially if they have any type of job. Then essentially, zakat is obligatory on any Muslim living in this land. Now the issue of zakat on gold and silver, really we can give many, many lectures. I'm sure our sheikh can give us hours of evidences on both sides. In a nutshell, the Hanafi school of law says that zakat is obligatory on female jewelry, gold and silver. If you own gold and silver, it is obligatory on them. And this is actually the position of many non-Hanafi scholars of our times as well, because the ahadith seem to be very explicit here. But the other three madhabs, the Hanbalis, the Shafi'is, and the Malikis, they say, generally speaking, the personal jewelry that is owned by women, it constitutes the same as the clothes and the garments and the household items, so it will be excluded from zakah. So if you follow one of the four madhabs I've given you, if you ask me what my personal position is, even though I'm generally a Hanbali, but in this issue, I think the texts are very explicit and the ahadith are very explicit. The Prophet ﷺ entered upon Umm Salama and she was wearing some jewelry and she asked, did you give zakat on this or did you give your charity on this? So Allah knows best, but the position of most of my own teachers, even though they're not Hanafi, most of my own teachers that actually follow the Hanafi position in this regard, and it is my own also household thing that we give zakat on the jewelry in the house because of the explicit nature. But again, this is only the gold and silver jewelry, not the jewelry that is non-gold and silver. Who do we give zakat to? Zakat is given by explicit text of the Quran to 8 categories. This is mentioned in Surah At-Tawbah. إِنَّمَا الصَّدَقَاتُ لِلْفُقَرَاءِ وَالْمَسَاكِينَ, and 8 categories are mentioned. And for our purposes, the first two are the most relevant. The others are either impossible or difficult for us to do. For example, one of the 8 categories is freeing slaves. No longer there. One of the 8 categories is that those that are in legitimate debts. And there's a long list of criterion what constitutes a legitimate debt. One of the 8 categories is the traveler who is away from his land. He doesn't have access to his wealth. He might be wealthy in his land, but by the time he reaches your land, he doesn't have wealth. Well, in our times, because of bank accounts, credit cards, again, that's very, very rare. So realistically speaking, for example, one of the 8 categories, those non-Muslims who we want to give zakat to, that their hearts become soft towards Islam. The Arabic is مُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Our Prophet ﷺ would give zakat. And by the way, of the 8 categories, this is the only category that you can give zakat to a non-Muslim. Otherwise, the other 7 categories must be Muslim. The one exception, when the Islamic ruler decides that so-and-so, we need to soften his animosity towards Islam, and that is done by money. And it is authentically known in the seerah that after the battle of Tabuk and Hunayn, our Prophet ﷺ gave large quantities of zakah to specific tribal chieftains who might have attacked Islam, who might have harmed Islam. But by giving them that wealth, essentially the Muslims were protected. Well, that category, me and you don't decide. It is the ruler. It is the Khalifa that does that. So for our purposes, really, what we are down to is essentially al-fuqara'i wal-masakeen, faqir and miskeen. What is the difference between faqir and miskeen? Majority of scholars say the faqir is the one that he doesn't own anything. He's like the street beggar. And the miskeen is the one, he might own stuff, he might even have more than the nisab, but it's not enough for him to live a life that is comfortable for the average human being of your society. And so faqir is basically, let's say, the homeless person, the street beggar, he has nothing. And the miskeen might have a house, he might have a car he's driving, but he's in debt and he cannot pay the bills for his family, even though maybe he has furniture that is more than the nisab. If he had to sell, he would, but he doesn't have enough to live a regular life of a person of your background and culture. Like for example, in America, what is the poverty line? So this is the miskeen, and the miskeen is worthy of zakat. So this is the main category that we will give zakat to, and zakat cannot be given to blood relatives that depend on us for rizq. For example, the wife or the children or the parents, they cannot be given zakah because you must take care of them. However, they can be given to extended family. And so in most circumstances, not all, in most circumstances, you can give zakah to, let's say, sisters and brothers. Definitely you can give zakah to cousins and uncles and aunts. Definitely you can give zakah to extended family. And in fact, giving zakah to extended family, if they deserve it, obviously, if they're faqir or miskeen, giving zakah to them is more rewarded than giving zakah elsewhere. As well, our scholars say zakah should begin locally, but it is okay to send to other places as well. So many of our teachers taught us that we should divide zakat into three categories. This is not fiqh, this is just adab. One third should be local, and one third may be relatives in another land, and one third to causes that are zakat eligible. This is just a rule of thumb. It's nothing from the fiqh. It's just basically to diversify your zakat investment in the eyes of Allah. That you should. But in the end of the day, if you have a distant cousin who is genuinely, let's say she's widowed, she has children, she's in a desperate situation, she's your cousin, you may give all of your zakat to that person, and that is completely fine. But our scholars say if you're able to, then you should diversify so that you get multiple reward. As well, you do not have to tell the recipient that you are giving zakat. You may say, oh, this is a gift. And in your heart, you have the niyyah of zakat. However, for it to be zakat, you must have the niyyah before you give. Suppose you give somebody a gift. Then the next day you say, oh, I actually owe zakah, let me make that a zakah. Too late. It must be given. The niyyah has to be in your heart before you give the zakah. And according to the strongest opinion, and this is hotly debated in our times. In our times, many ulama are having intellectual debates over this issue. I myself am deeply involved in this. But still, the majority opinion is that zakat is given to individuals and not institutions. Zakat is given to individuals who need it and not to institutions. Now, I personally follow the position that only some institutions we can give zakat to. Don't just make it open to any institution. If the institution is, let's say, an orphanage, let's say. In this case, maybe inshallah it is permissible to give zakat because it is an orphanage. You're building an orphan for the people who need it. Otherwise, believe it or not, the majority of scholars historically have said zakat should not be given even to building an orphanage. They said zakat is given to human beings, not to institutions. In our times, many ulama are debating this issue. They're looking at the world and how difficult it is to live. And they're saying institutions that serve a public good for the Muslim community, they may be given zakah. My position is kind of in the middle, case by case basis. We look at the institution, we see what it is doing. So for example, just a generic hospital, it's problematic in my opinion to give zakah because not everybody who is treated is poor. If it's treating for free, maybe a rich person will come. That's not mustahiq al-zakah. But suppose, theoretically, you could guarantee that everybody being treated was a poor person. In my humble opinion, in this case, you can give zakah to such an institution. But the point is, this is an area of controversy. The majority of scholars say zakah is given to individuals. Inshallah, this is part one. Tomorrow, we'll get to the technical stuff of stocks and mutual funds and 401ks. And inshallah, then we'll go into more detail. Until then, jazakumullah khair. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. صلى عليك الله يا خير الورى تعداد حبات الرمال وأكثرا صلى عليك الله ما غيث هما فوق السهول وبالجبال وبالقرى فوق السهول وبالجبال وبالقرى. بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه ما بعد. Today we'll continue part two of our lecture on zakah. It'll be a little bit technical, but I apologize for that, but it needs to be done in terms of how to give zakah. And I want to begin by stating that modern rules of zakah are obviously varied. We're not talking about classical fiqh, we're talking about stocks, we're talking about mutual funds, we're talking about 401k. Obviously, our modern scholars have tried their best to make ijtihad, and you will find a spectrum of opinion. Therefore, my advice to you all, don't play games with the sharia. Allah knows your intention. Allah knows you're trying your best. And Allah will judge you based upon your intention. Try your best, and Allah knows your sincerity. Ask the sheikh that you trust, and then follow that advice. So very briefly, how do we give zakat on our liquid assets? Technically, zakat is due on the amount that a person has owned for a whole lunar year, as we said. So our scholars, in trying to make Islam easy for us, they gave us a simple rule. They said, the fact that most of us are salaried employees and that our bank accounts are going to vary every single month, they advised us the following. Choose one date of the year. And we're doing this lecture in Ramadan because most of us choose a date in Ramadan. 15th Ramadan, 20th Ramadan, 1st Ramadan. Choose one date of the year. That is your zakat date. And every single date, that same date, all that you do is you look at your liquid assets on that date and you pay 2.5% of your liquid assets on that date. You look at what you have in your bank account. You look at the cash that you have. You look at everything that is basically liquid assets on hand on that day, and you simply assume it to be your standard for the entire year. Now, alternatively, if you want to do the advance, then technically you have to see every single month from the last year how much you've had. You make a graph and a chart, and it gets very, very complicated very fast. That's why our scholar said the easy way, and inshallah it is permissible, because most of us on salaried checks, we're living on our salary checks, by and large your bank account varies slightly up and down. We have a steady balance, we know what that is, and generally speaking we have the similar amount on that date of our zakah. So we simply assume on that date, and we calculate simple 2.5%. Now that's liquid assets, that means our bank accounts, that means any cash that we have on hand, that means, as we said yesterday, the jewelry that is gold and silver. How about stocks? Stocks, once again, there are three or four opinions, and I'm not going to complicate things. I'll try to give you the simplest possible, but it can't be that easy. We have to divide stocks into two categories. The first are those that are active day traders. They go in, they're aggressive, they're monitoring the price, they're seeing when it goes up or down, they're going to sell. As soon as the price is right, they want to sell it. And the way you know active traders, you know who they are because they're checking the prices almost daily, maybe 10 times a day. They're actually day traders, they sell in the morning and day 8 times maybe. But if you're actively monitoring the price and you're wanting to sell as soon as the price is amenable to what you want, this is your active stock trading. You will deal with it like you deal with business merchandise, which means 2.5% of the paper value of the stock on the day of your zakah. So if your 20th Ramadan is the day of your zakah and you're an active stock trader, for example, you're buying and selling Uber, or you're buying and selling even a Bitcoin would be the same thing. So if you're buying and selling these types of stocks actively, or even Bitcoin is a type of currency, so if you're actively buying and selling on the 20th of Ramadan, you simply log on, you look at your value, and that 2.5% will be your zakat. Simple as that. Done deal. The problem comes, what if it's not an active trade? What if you are a long-term investor? What if you're just putting it into a mutual fund and you really are not monitoring the price, and it's really meant for a rainy day? It's meant for something long-term. And this is where really you get a spectrum of opinion, and it is a gray area. And I'm going to try to make it simple. Actually, I had a discussion with one of my teachers and mentors today so that I can give you an opinion that is coming from somebody more knowledgeable than me. And after a long discussion, and he's an expert in Islamic finance, the problem with mutual funds is that the zakat would only be due on those assets that are tangible. And so it gets a little bit complicated. To make it very short, what he suggested, if you have a mutual funds that is long term, which means you are not actively buying and selling, in that case, your zakat will be between 0.5 to 1% of the paper value. How he got to this percentage is a little bit more complicated, and I don't want to confuse you all, but the point is that on average, 30% of the mutual fund is zakatable, not 100%. Why? Because if it's a long-term investment, zakat is only due on the tangible assets, not on the services. And on average, a mutual fund might have around 30 to 40% of tangible assets. So basically, between 0.5 to 1%, if your mutual funds is more in the services sector, it'll go down. If it's more in the actual, if you're in the oil industry, you're actually in the mutual funds of buying and selling oil, mutual funds of gold. In that case, this tangible assets is going to go up a little bit more to the 1%. But basically, a rule of thumb, long-term investments that are mutual funds that you're not actively involved in buying and selling, then the zakat is roughly 30% of that value. So that translates as between 0.5 to 1% of the paper value that you're going to see on the day of your zakat. The 20th of Ramadan, you log on and you give between 0.5 and 1. 0.5 if it is more services, and 1 if it is more, 1% if it's more actual tangible assets. That's the range that my teacher and mentor gave. Now we move to the other problematic issue, and I'm going to confuse you a little bit more as well, and that is the 401k or the retirement one. And some of you already know what is going to come right now. I've been on this podium, mashallah, tabarakallah, 9 years in a row. Every year I give a lecture on zakat in Ramadan, and I have vacillated my opinion back and forth twice in the last 9 years. Now I'm going to vacillate one more time, three times, changing. And it's not my fault. This is Allah's qadr on us that we keep on changing our minds in this regard. And inshallah, it's a sign also of active research. 401k is definitely a very, very discussed area amongst the ulama. And for when I first came here, the fatwa I gave all of you, you should give zakat on the 401k amount. Around 5-6 years ago, I changed my position to that of Sheikh Qardawi and others who said you don't give zakat, and so you give zero zakat. Then 3 years ago, I joined the Fiqh Council of North America. For the last 2 years, we have been debating 401ks in our meetings. We are constantly, this has been the number one issue for the last 2 years of the Fiqh Council. What is the zakat on 401ks? Now, and in fact, we just finished our meeting last month, so the Fiqh Council of North America, which is the senior most oldest body of Islamic scholars of North America, and alhamdulillah, I'm a member of that, and I will respectfully follow their positions, and I'm a member, I have to follow their position as well. And actually now they have convinced me of this as well, that in fact, the position that is now from the Fiqh Council is the following. And that is that, the fatwa is that you will give zakat on the amount that is cashable after penalties and taxes. Okay? If you were to access that 401k, whatever the penalty is, get rid of it. Whatever you would get taxed, get rid of it. Then that final amount, 2.5% of that theoretical amount. Let me give you a simple example. Suppose your 401k had 200,000 in it, and you have a 20% penalty if you were to cash it out. So if you have a 20% penalty, that makes it to 160,000. Suppose your tax bracket is roughly 25%. So 160,000 then goes to 120,000. Okay, now you calculate 2.5% of that 120,000, and that works out to $3,000. $3,000, that's ma'khul, that's reasonable. If your 401k is 300,000, then $200,000, then $3,000 is reasonable amount for you to give. Now, one of the discussions in our Fiqh Council was, what if somebody is at the end of retirement, he has 300,000, 200,000, excuse me, but he doesn't have 3,000 of his check to give. What does he do then? So the fatwa then is the following. It's very simple. 3,000 is a debt owed to Allah. And Allah will forgive that debt until you can pay it. So if you can pay 1,000 of that 3,000, you pay it now, and you write down on a piece of paper 2,000 for 2019. Next year, another 2,000. Next year, another. When you finally cash out your 250,000, if you actually add it up, your debt owed was going to be maybe 7,000, 8,000, 9,000 in zakat. And so you will pay it when you cash out. But it is a debt owed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah will not ask you to forcibly cash out your 401k if you cannot afford to pay. So very simple. You pay what you can of that 2.5% that is cashable. Clear enough? And whatever you cannot, you just make a note of it, that for this year I wasn't able to pay that much, and it is an easy debt. It's a non-binding debt until you cash out the 401k. When you cash out the 401k, then you add up those debts, and generally speaking, it's not payable for those of us that are struggling at the end of our retirement, not at the beginning. At the beginning, the 401k will be 15,000, 25,000, 35,000, it's going to be reasonable. But towards the end of our, you know, closer to retirement, maybe it is a very large amount and we cannot afford to pay, in which case, Afallahu amma salafa la yukallifu Allahu nafsan illa wus'aha. You pay what you can, and you just make a note that I wasn't able to pay this much, and when you actually cash out the 401k, you will then pay that as zakat, as a one-off. And this is, I think, a reasonable fatwa, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. The final issue that we're going to discuss is zakat on business commodities. What if you own a business? Those who buy and sell business commodities, those who buy and sell merchandise, for example, you own a gas store, a convenience store, you own a furniture store, you must give zakat on the value of the commodities that are actually purchased and sold. And you will calculate 2.5% on the day of your zakat. So 20th of Ramadan, you will do an inventory, your stock, and whatever is the retail value, whatever is the general market value of that merchandise, you will pay 2.5% of zakat on that. And Allah knows you are trying your best, you're not having a trick that the day before your zakat is due, you get rid of your merchandise. Allah knows this, that you're playing a fair game, and whatever is the 2.5% on the day of your your zakat, that is going to be calculated. Zakat is due only on merchandise that is purchased and sold. If you own something that you rent, for example, rental property, for example, you own a house and it is meant for rent, you do not give zakat on the cost of the house. You give zakat on the rental income that you have had for a year. So basically, if you have a house that you're renting out, you're going to get money. The money is going to go in your bank account. Therefore, the zakat will be on the money with the rest of your money that you will calculate on the 20th of Ramadan. Zakat is not due on the cost of the item that is rented. Zakat is only due 2.5% on merchandise that is purchased and sold. And I said the final point, one other point, zakat on loans. Zakat on loans. When it comes to loans, in a nutshell, the Sharia distinguishes between what are called hard loans and soft loans. And to put it in a very easy manner, if the money is as if it is non-existent, you can ignore it. Suppose you gave somebody $10,000 and the person is in struggling circumstances. You don't know when this person is going to pay back. Then there is no zakat because you don't have anything of that. But suppose the person has now the capacity to pay you back, but you're just not asking because you don't need it. I mean, okay, whenever I want to, I'll ask it back. And you know that this brother, or you assume that this brother can pay you back 10,000. In this case, there is zakat. You will have to add it that, hey, this person owes me 10,000, and all I have to do is make a phone call, but I don't need it. That's why I just don't want to cause any issues. Whenever I need it, I'll call him. In this case, the 10,000 will be added to the amount of zakat. However, if it's a soft loan and also a long-term loan, then there is no a deduction of zakat because all of us have long-term loans that are payable in installments. If we were to do that, the average Muslim has a mortgage, and so all of us are negative assets anyway. We do not take into account large long-term loans when it comes to zakat. We ignore them. We have a house mortgage of $300,000. That does not come under zakat. There is no calculation. We don't subtract $300,000 from our net assets, or else every one of us would be negative. It's only short-term loans that are solid, that we know we have access to. Those are the ones that we will add to our zakat. Otherwise, we do not add that to our zakat. Obviously, zakat cannot be given on haram money. The purpose of zakat is to purify. So if we seek Allah's refuge, if one of us has income that is haram, the concept of paying zakat on that is ludicrous. It is nonsensical. It doesn't make any sense. The purpose of zakat is to purify. And so if a person owns a liquor store, if a person has something completely haram, and they're getting this money completely from haram, this is the month of Ramadan, they need to repent from that money in totality, and they should get rid of that money and give it to the poor. Allah will reward them for their pure intention and not for the deed and money itself, because the money is filthy. Wallahu tayyibun wa la yaqbalu illa tayyiba. Allah only accepts that which is pure. And to conclude, therefore, try your best. Fattaqullaha mastata'tum. This is the month of Ramadan, the month of charity. Try your best to make a reasonable calculation of zakah. Diversify your investments in zakat as well. Give to various funds as well. And if you allow me a quick plug, I myself have a project that I'm doing, which is to open up a school for the Kashmiri refugees, which is zakat eligible because 10% of them are orphans, so that zakat goes to the orphans. I have visited the province and I'm directly involved. If you're interested, you can come and speak to me or log on to the videos as well. But give zakat to every single charity that you feel comfortable, and the best zakat that you give will be to extended family and relatives that need it. And the best zakat is not told to them, it is given to them as a gift, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows it is zakah. May Allah accept our sadaqah in this month, and inshallah we'll continue in regular khatiras tomorrow. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Salla alayka Allahu ya khayr al-wara, ti'dad habbati al-rimali wa akthara. Salla alayka Allahu ma ghaythun hama, فوق السهول وبالجبال وبالقرى، فوق السهول وبالجبال وبالقرى.